How to use vertical separation. What is the closest two IFR aircraft can be from each other in the air? The correct answer is only 300 meters or 1,000 feet. That distance we're talking about here is the vertical separation minima, one of the most commonly used separation methods that we have in our ATC toolbox. The basic rule is that below flight level 290, the minimum vertical separation is 1,000 feet, and at or above flight level 290, it is 2,000 feet. But there's an exception to this. RVSM, check this out. A long time ago, it was clear that most of the commercial air traffic would prefer flying at cruising altitudes above flight level 290 for efficiency and fuel economy. ICAO needed to come up with something to ease the congestion high up in the sky, because the 2,000 feet vertical separation requirement made the cruising levels a bottleneck for smooth air travel. The solution, reduced vertical separation minima, was eventually introduced in the 1980s, and different parts of the world started implementing it in the 90s and in the 2000s. RVSM had a huge impact in improving the efficiency of the airspace. It meant that airline operators could get an approval for their aircraft to fly in the RVSM airspace between flight levels 290 and 410, and the vertical separation between all these RVSM approved aircraft would be the same 1,000 feet as below the RVSM airspace. Currently, almost all traffic is RVSM approved, and the airspace is in use pretty much everywhere, making the requirement of the 2,000 feet vertical separation applicable only at flight levels above 410. And to be fair, the skies are not that crowded so high up in the air. Then how do we use this vertical separation? Whenever any type of horizontal or radar separation is not used to separate the flights, then vertical it is. For example, when the paths of two flights are crossing, and one of them is flying at an altitude of 3,000 feet and the other one at 4,000 feet, they are vertically separated. Or two RVSM approved flights are flying on cruising levels 340 and 350. They are also vertically separated. It's the beauty of RVSM. Two aircraft can be head-on towards each other, flying almost at the speed of sound, and the situation is fully in control. The only challenge is when the vertical separation has to be applied in a situation where one aircraft is at transition level and another one below. To learn how this is handled, check out this video here. But the vertical separation is also used on lower levels near the airports by directly assigning altitude instructions to the aircraft or by flight procedure design. Let me show you how. Sometimes pilots wonder why they are instructed to expedite their climb or descend or to fly a certain point at a specified altitude, even if it disrupts their optimum continuous descent profile. One of the most common reasons for this is the destination airport having multiple runways which are used for independent approaches. The runways for this operation have to be at least 1 to 1.5 kilometers apart, depending on different factors like the accuracy of the ATC radar system. That 1.5 kilometer distance may sound a lot on the ground, but in the air, it is definitely not. For these simultaneous independent approaches, using vertical separation is critical. When the traffic is flying on parallel downwinds, there has to be a vertical separation in place before the aircraft can be turned into the base legs. For obvious reasons, it wouldn't be safe to have two aircraft flying exactly toward each other at the same altitude. If even one of the aircraft turns too slowly and overshoots the localizer, the consequences could be disastrous. This is why sometimes the controller needs to expedite the descent of the aircraft that is planned to be the lower one, 1,000 feet below the other. Going down too slowly will result in extended downwinds and having a knock-on effect on the following traffic as well. Another example of how vertical separation is used is when there is more than one airport in the terminal area, and the arrival and departure routes for these airports have to work together without conflicts. In these cases, there are climb and descend constraints included in the SIDs and STARs. For example, all the departing aircraft from Airfield A towards the west must cross this point at 5,000 feet or above, because there are arrivals to Airfield B flying below. And vice versa, those arrivals must cross this point at 4,000 feet or below for the system to work properly. The more complex the airspace is, the more level restrictions there has to be. But the vertical separation of 1,000 feet works every single time. Want to learn more? Join us for more ATC training videos. See you there.